Morning, everybody in the United States, afternoon in Europe, evening, I guess, in Australia. Thank you, Ram, for the introduction. I'm going to talk a bit about different ways of targeting the VHL signaling pathway in treating VHL. There are several examples of how to go from the bedside to the clinic, and I'm going to present some of the essentially approaches that we took in my laboratory, but several approaches actually be taken by many labs that are complementary and different to these ones. In our lab at MGH Cancer Center, Harvard Medical School, we're interested in renal cell carcinoma and VHL disease. And it turns out that we can use this model disease as a disease of altered cancer metabolism. There are several mutations, as you know, that are generating renal cell carcinoma, VHL being leader initiating tumor suppressor gene, which is responsible for approximately 90% of renal cell carcinomas. What we do in the lab is we're using biochemical approaches, animal model approaches, and metabolomics as well as gene expression profile to understand how we can target VHL related tumors and non VHL related renal cell carcinomas, and we hope and we have done to bring some of these observations in clinical trials. I'm not going to talk about VHL signaling pathway to this audience. Put this slide up only to say that there are different ways to target the HIV pathway. One of them is to target downstream targets like VEGF and PDGF and TGF, and that has been for a while the way of doing it, and later we can target directly the HIV signaling pathway with HIV alpha inhibitors. Important detail in this presentation is to note that HIF to alpha, the regulatory subunit, has to interact with a heterodimer, the RN subunit. This interaction is required for its transcriptional activity, and small molecule inhibitor, which is actually in clinical trials, we're going to talk about this in a second, disrupts this interaction, inhibits HIF to alpha activity. My lab several years ago, it's kind of an historical slide right now, along with many other laboratories, established that HIF is a validated target for renal cell cancers. And this has been done here in xenograft animal models, but has also been done in transgenic animal models. The conclusion of a series of studies for several labs almost back 15 years ago now is that inhibition of HIF phenocopies kind of the reintroduction of VHL. So it is good and sufficient to target HIF to cause tumor suppression. With this in mind, our approach to develop a direct targeting inhibition of HIF was to set up a cell-based assay, high throughput, to discover small molecules that they will be HIF inhibitors. We indeed did discover these molecules, and we saw that they target with high accuracy HIF to alpha inhibitors by gene expression analysis. So the gene signature, the gene expression signature of treating the cells with these molecules was very similar or almost identical to the signature of reintroducing VHL of inactivating HIF. We spent a considerable time in two directions. One of them is to find out the mechanism of action of these molecules, and the second one is to look at and prove that they are efficacious in vivo. And I will talk about this, both of these things in the next slides. The way that these molecules are working mechanistically is that they are forcing an endocellular protein, iron response regulatory protein 1, to sit in the 5-UTR untranslated part of the HIF to alpha mRNA and suppress its translation. This is a highly specific function. It does not target HIF-1 alpha, and it does not involve and engage the IRP2, which is another endocellular protein. So this mechanism, we're going to go back to this mechanism in the future, because it was actually the inspiration to launch into the metabolic studies. We work on these molecules, and we wanted to show that these are efficacious, and because the pharmacokinetic behavior that they had was not optimal, we used a couple of years ago a zebrafish model, VHL, null model, which recapitulates elements of the disease, and we saw that if we treat the fish with this molecule, we decrease the erythropoiesis and other features of the VHL disease in a dose-dependent manner with reasonable concentrations. And in the end, we also use the xenograft animal models to treat empirically, and again, not with an optimal concentration, mice that they have been xenografted with human renal cell carcinomas. And we showed that essentially the HIF2-alpha inhibitors decrease VHRE activity, and over a period of 3 weeks administration, they suppressed back then the tumor formation at a level similar to the level of the sunitinib. We spent the last approximately 2 years in using the chemical, these HIF inhibitors as chemical tools. And what I mean by this is that we use them to identify their direct targets in cells. We show that they bind endocellular proteins covalently, and we produce a series of small molecules that they have the ability to be tagged with streptavidin, and they have different properties. Some of them are very active, and some of them, with a very small modification, are completely losing their activity, and therefore we can use them as a controls to identify cellular proteins. And you can see in the derivative compound 83 that we can fish out of the cell a set of endocellular proteins that they are not present when we're using inactive forms of the drug. We now know the identity of most, not of all, of these proteins, and we're proceeding with a validating experiment. So on the one hand, we were interested in direct clinical therapeutics. On the other hand, we're interested in a chemical biology that we will provide some more understanding about the insights into the regulation of the HIF expression in the VHL negative cell and how to inhibit it. Two words, because Dr. Jonas is going to talk extensively about this, present extensively in this meeting. As you all know, that was an approach that suppresses HIF2-alpha translation, but there has been a quite more developed approach, which is disrupt this interaction of HIF2-alpha with the ARNT inhibitor, through an inhibitor that has been marketed at the beginning by Peloton, now acquired by Merck. We were heavily involved, along with other sites, in the clinical development of this drug. The MGH has been one of the sites and contributed several patients in the study. And the very good news for the patients and the scientific community is that what we see is that we see significant responses to this orally administered, very well tolerated medication. You can see in the left side, after the nodal point here of administration of the drug, a gradual increase of the tumors in several individuals. Every line presents a different individual. And on the right side of the slide, you can see that this growth rate has been either plateaued or declined in several patients. Therefore, this medication is very efficient for renal cell carcinoma, in VHL patients and other tumors. And besides the great news for the clinical, the great news for the administration of this medication, the therapeutic value in the patients also validates in a clinical trial in human population the validity, the value of HIF as a target. Let me go back to the bench now and present you another way to target HIF-expressing tumors. And this way is not by directly targeting HIF, but by essentially developing a parallel approach that would exploit the function of the HIF to kill the HIF-expressing cell. I told you before that the way that these small molecules work is by precipitating IRP1, the 5-UTR of a HIF2-alpha. IRP1, the same nucleotide sequence, if you remove an iron, it's an enzyme of The intermediate metabolism is called a conitase, and this function is to convert citrate to isocitrate. Therefore, we thought that this is a very interesting example, another example in cancer where metabolism talks directly to a signaling pathway, and we wanted to reverse the question and ask how a signaling pathway talks to metabolism. We showed in a series of studies for the first time in mammalian cells that when cells are under hypoxic conditions or they're losing VHL and they express HIF, they divert glucose away from the Krebs cycle, and the Krebs cycle is very important for production of biomass, of lipids, of amino acids, for generation of ATP, which is the basic molecule of energy in the cell, and for detoxification of reactive oxygen species. So glucose is required for these functions, but VHL negative cells and HIF expressing cells do not allow glucose to enter the TCA cycle. Instead, we showed that they use glutamine, which they convert to glutamate, and then they can either convert further in an oxidative fashion, the classic Krebs cycle, or what we described was reductive carboxylation, in which they reduce and they carboxylate glutamate to form citrate. Well, these unique features gave us actually the idea that there is a possibility, but to starve selectively the VHL negative cells from glutamine. And indeed, there was a small molecule which it inhibits the enzyme of glutaminase 1. Glutaminase 1 is required to go from glutamine to glutamate. And we use this molecule to target VHL negative cells. We saw that the glutaminase 1 selectively targets the cells. And the right side of this slide, you can see a xenograft experiment in which the black line is the vehicle control and the red line is the glutaminase inhibitor. We have some relative suppression of tumor formation. What came more important and quite surprising and exciting to us is that when we study the mechanism by which glutaminase inhibits the development of tumors, we realize that it does this by restricting the availability of nucleotides, which ends up results in DNA damage. You see this DNA damage on the left side by this fragmentation of the DNA elongation. And so we exploited this feature by combining the glutaminase inhibitor with inhibitors of the PARP enzymes. PARP enzymes are required for repairs in the DNA damage. Classic one, which is in the clinic, is olaparib. So the combination of CB and olaparib, the green line here, shows a dramatic decline in tumor growth. And this is now in clinical trials in renal cell carcinoma nationwide, as well as in several tumors. I've spent the last 5 to 10 minutes of my presentation to talk about, which is not directly in the interest of the VHL patients, but which actually gives a lot of ammunition in the banner with which the VHL Alliance goes forward, that we're using VHL and an understanding of VHL-HIF interaction to treat other non-exclusively VHL-related tumors. So there's another tumor that looks like clear cell carcinoma. It's called clear cell ovarian cancer. Under the microscope, it has the same lipid laden formation like the clear cell carcinoma. And it is a tumor that expresses high levels of HIF through mechanisms that they are not having established, but we're suspecting, and I think we're in the process of proving right now in the lab. Indeed, when we look at normal epithelium versus the CCOC, this is clear cell carcinoma cell lines, tumor samples, we show that the clear cell carcinoma expresses high levels of both HIF-1 alpha and HIF-2 alpha. And we use several of these clear cell carcinoma ovarian clear cell cancer cell lines to test their sensitivity on the glutaminase inhibitor, following exactly the rationale and the notion that HIF-expressing tumors should be sensitive to the glutaminase inhibitor. In contrast to renal cell carcinoma, which is almost uniformly sensitive to glutaminase inhibitors, there is a spectrum of sensitivity in the cell line. Some of them are sensitive, indicated here in blue, and some of them are resistance, indicated in red. This is the sensitive and the resistance aligns. But if you take the sensitive, of course, aligns, you can recapitulate the same experiments that we have done renal cell carcinoma in animal models. So if you inject orthotopically the ovarian cell lines, the peritoneum of the mice, you can treat them with CB and you can treat them with a combination of glutaminase inhibitor and the olaparib and so that you have a significant decrease in the growth of the tumor and an extension, significant extension in the survival of the animals. We asked the question if this is due to the HIF2 alpha or in this case to the HIF1 alpha because this alliance expressed both paralogs, and we showed, not to our surprise, but very pleasant to repeat this experiment, that inactivation of the HIF-2 alpha did not confer a lot of change in their sensitivity, but inactivation of HIF-2 alpha made the cell lines more resistant to glutaminase inhibitors. And finally, we took and we did an RNA expression analysis between the sensitives and the resistance lines at the baseline and when treated. And we saw that there is a set of genes that are uniquely expressed in the, significantly expressed in the resistance, but not the sensitive cell lines. And I will mention the relativity, meaning of this for renal cell carcinoma in a second. So these genes and the proteins were the transmembrane protein SLC1A3. This is a soluble transporter, soluble carrier, and this protein imports aspartate and glutamate in the cell. We also found that it's requiring the presence and the co-expression of chalbidin-1 in the cell. So it makes perfect sense if you look at it, because what we do is that we starve the cells from glutamine. The starvation of the glutamine has an outcome, the restriction of aspartate and of glutamate. And so what the cells do is that they upregulate the receptor that they take directly from the environment, aspartate and glutamate. This receptor co-imports sodium, and for biochemical, cascade reactions that they're out of the purpose of this presentation, require buffering of calcium by chalbidin 1 in the cells. And that's why this gene scores very high in the resistance lines too. And we did all the next reasonable experiments in which we inactivated this transporter of the cell surface membrane. We saw that indeed we made the cells very sensitive to the glutaminase, and then we expressed in the sensitive cell lines the transporter, and we saw that that renders them resistant to the glutaminase inhibitor. And the reason I am coming back to this is to tell you that similar studies that we have done in renal cell carcinoma showed that these mechanisms of upregulating transporters, that they take nutrients from the environment, is also operative and very robust as a mechanism of developing resistance of renal cell carcinoma to glutaminase inhibitor. So this has been a synthetic lethality kind of approach to treat renal cell carcinoma with metabolic interventions, and we're building up more on this as the metabolic target will come to the clinic to complement the direct cellular targeting of VHL negative cells. I want to thank several investigators in my presentation, but I want to primarily say, given the symposium here, that we're very grateful to the VHL Alliance for supporting not this direct research, but the research that we have done in another aspect of the lab, and I hope to present later in the future, that has to do with the biology of the hemangioblastoma. Thank you.